welcome.
A Boom Boom Lemon production presents.
Don't knock the wall.
Smash writing.
I am your host, Paul. Justin, we are back at it.
Took Paul way too goddamn long.
We moved. Got a new office. So we are now going to do this idea that we had 3 months ago.
Yay!
We are reviewing.
We are professionals. Remember that. At his funeral.
Hold on, I gotta scratch my butt. Okay.
He's a fucking dumbass. You're laughing, but they're just turned off. The two people left. No, sorry.
So we are talking, we're ranking our best action films from the previous decade.
2010 to 2019.
Yep. And here is our top 10.
Yeah, I was kind of disappointed when we went back and looked through. There was not a whole lot. I know the comic book movies dominated the decade, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So we tried to do our best to limit them.
Yeah, I mean, we didn't, like, I didn't put a role in, like, but we unofficially, it was like, you know, in our heads, like, there were a lot of comic book films that were actually very good in this decade.
Because if I would have, like free-falled it, like, this probably would have just been top 10 comic book movies. There may be, like, one or two exceptions to the rule.
And that can be another idea for another day.
No, it's not. Fuck, it is.
Oh, what? It's going to be, like, Hellboy number one.
It's a matter of opinion. Like, I'm not one of the people who believes that comic book movies aren't cinema, because that's fucking dumb.
The amount of work that goes into it, it's still hard work. I mean, green screen or not.
The actors still have to deliver.
Yeah. But let's get to our top 10. Justin, head us off.
My number 10 is probably shocking for you because of how little I like these movie genres.
It really, really was.
I'm not a big fan of the big monsters, but Kong Skull Island delivered. It's the gold standard of the big monsters. I thought the actors were really good in it. John Goodman, Samuel L. Jackson, Loki, and Captain Marvel, both of them were entertaining. I loved their roles in it.
Brie Larson and Tom Hiddleston?
Yeah.
You just called them there.
Yeah, I know I did, because I couldn't remember how to say Hiddleston's last name. I always get it. Hiddleston? Middleston?
Hiddle. It starts with an H, not professionals.
I can't remember all of their names.
That is true. We go through millions of actors here.
No, millions. Not even close.
Thousands.
Dozens and dozens.
Okay.
But no, it's an entertaining movie. You're in there for the big monster. If you want to see the big ape throw around the helicopters, they deliver that. You want to see some actors performing on the ground level with a story going around them, there's that. Good movie, all the way around.
My number 10 is Pacific Rim. Transformers was like...
This is why I don't like the big monster movies.
Yeah. Transformers was like really big. And, of course, this had to capitalize on it, which was fine, because they added a new touch where, like, you're in the robot and it's hooked to your, like, brain. The story was thin, but the graphics moved with the robots moving.
It's like Transformers meets Real Steel.
I mean, I would blend it kind of like that description. But nevertheless, like I said, the story was thin. There really wasn't too much to it. You had your typical people on the black market trying to sell, like, the blood from these Cajuns. These monsters came up from the...
Kaijus.
Came from the Pacific Rim, where the split is in the Earth's crust. And it's up to a team of soldiers to get in these robots and, you know...
Punch them in the face.
Yes. And the difference is, like...
It's just punch.
If the robot takes a beating... You take a beating too, you know. And if you exert too much power, too much, I guess, life force, whatever you want to call it, in this movie, you know, you start to get dizzy because you're giving the robot too much.
You could just say you like watching big monster punch big robot.
Yeah, it was still a fun little ride. I enjoyed it. That was my number 10. I'll do my number 9 so we can bang out your nine.
You weren't paying attention.
Paying attention to what?
If you would have paid attention, you would have started, so we could have just played naturally.
We like to mix it up.
They don't mix it up. You stumble.
My number 9 from 2017. So mad that this does not have a sequel.
Yeah, I really wanted to see Tommy.
Yeah.
I really wanted to see
no matter
Tommy
what version they were going to give you, male, female, whatever, it didn't matter. But, of course, I am talking about Power Rangers from 2017.
I really, like, female Tommy would have kicked all the kind of ass in this world.
Not only that, they took literally what was a kid's show from the 90s and made it for all of the audience.
They actually followed up with the song, you know, Teenagers with Attitude.
Yeah.
Did you see any attitude from the cartoon? I didn't see any attitude from this.
No, they were all good old teenagers, you know? That were like, oh no, we're Power Rangers now. But in this one, they weren't that cut and dry. They were good at heart, but they did, each one had their flaws. The Red Ranger.
He stole the cow from the rival high school.
Yeah, and then gets in the accident. Yeah,
they kill the cow.
Yeah, and it, when
the
I
bowl.
Seen it,
he stole the bowl.
When I seen it in theaters, what really was like, I knew I was hooked on it, was basically when I heard them swear and make a adult joke regarding bowl.
Yeah, the bowl. He milked the bowl.
Like, how did you milk the, what did you milk? It was like, oh, it was that. Then, you know, the bring in, it had a good cast. Like I said, every Power Ranger had its own flaw. They weren't stand-up citizens. But they came together. One of the things that this movie took a beating on was how long it took them to get their Ranger suits. I disagreed.
So I like to recommend you had to earn it.
Yeah, that's
you
what
couldn't
I like.
Just get them because anyone could put the suit on them.
Like they were trying and they morphed a little bit, but it wasn't enough to sustain the suit. And then they argued, and then they realized when they needed each other, that's when it all clicked. I really liked it because, like you said, it earned them that suit. They just didn't put a coin in a morpher and became Rangers. So mad that
I like the Rita too.
Rita
Repulsa was really
and being original Green Ranger, like how they altered the stories with how the power coins.
Because that could have been like real, especially getting a new Green Ranger and how that would affect.
Yeah, they
them moving on if Rita is actually like possessing the Green Ranger, or was the Green Ranger always just
her
possession?
Yeah,
you know?
This thing did a lot of right for the franchise, and to this day. And we're, what, 5 years after the fact? I'm pissed that there's not a Power Rangers 2.
And we're not getting it. No reboot.
And never,
no.
Yeah, it's done. But nevertheless, that's my number 9.
My number 9, he did this so he could match up his number 8, is Hardcore Henry. This movie was an experience. This was the story. And, like, not really there. But the experience of Hardcore Henry is one of a kind, amazing.
Yeah.
He's puking in the lobby.
This is wonderful. Here's the thing, he's exaggerating, but not by much. This was one of those movies where we were early on in Smash writing.
I was not a part of Smash writing.
You were like a guest.
No, I was not doing reviews yet.
Oh, so this was literally us just going to see
it. Yeah, we just went and saw it.
So, when we went to go see this, and it was your idea, right? Because, yeah, this was
This was my revenge for him. Not really revenge, but because you called me. No, you didn't call me. You texted me like, I don't have anyone to go see Batman or Superman with. I don't want to go alone.
Boy, have things changed.
Yeah. So I agreed to go see Batman or Superman, but then I called him like, you're going to Hardcore Henry. 10:30, let's go.
Yep. And so we did, and That's the first person experience.
They're like, he doesn't have vocal cords. That got ruined during the medical experience.
Yeah.
Like, all right, fine, I'm there. And then it's like this action video game experience all the way through.
What made me love it was actually just a first timer.
Yeah.
You had probably movies that probably touched a few scenes of it.
Well, like Doom, they did that first person sequence in Doom, which was amazing. And then you get Hardcore Henry, that's just like an entire movie.
Yeah.
Go.
And the crazy thing, when he's flipping, that's what got me motion sickness, was like, I'm just tumbling like this. I'm like, oh my God. Only two movies I ever got dizzy and nauseous on. And ironically enough, they're both on this list. Which is, one is Hardcore Henry. The story was...
It was alright. It was a guy who had lost his memory trying to piece things together.
Yeah. And...
just action from top to bottom.
Top to bottom. Pure action. It was nothing more than action. And that's
like I said, this is less. You don't watch Hardcore Henry so much for the story. You're watching Hardcore Henry for the experience.
Yeah.
And they deliver an experience throughout this
movie. Like I said, for me, this was a first of a kind, so that's why it's going to make my list good. Hard to believe that was in 2016,
yeah,
but...
Yeah, when you're old.
But that is our 9 and 8. Let's go with...
My number 8. This is going to piss off everyone. The last two people who stayed on here to watch you scratch your ass. They're leaving now. They're gone. Captain Marvel. Captain Marvel remains one of my favorite from the series. I don't even know why. I just really like it. It's a good movie.
I like
Brie Larson going through and she thinks she's fighting a good fight. Just like, no, you're not. you're fighting the wrong fight here.
There's
a coming of age for her in a way. And introduce a powerhouse character that Marvel needed to have going against Thanos. Like how important introducing this character at that exact moment was for the storyline. I can't wait for the sequels.
It was one of those ones where... You know, there's just... I think there are so many more comic book movies. I did enjoy it.
Yeah.
It's just... There's already too many above it to really... put this on my list or even make the list when there are so many comic book films.
You say that, but I'm looking at your list here, man.
Yeah, I know. And here's our number 7, which...
Yeah, our number 7s are tied.
Yeah. Yeah. And our number 7 is, of course, from 2018.
Tomb Raider.
The reboot. Hoping it was the reboot.
Yeah.
And...
I've got the writer name down. I'm an idiot. Hang on.
He gets his... I'm surprised you don't have it in your notes.
I forgot to write it down. I'm an idiot. This was a fun movie. It introduced us to Lara Croft. An early Lara Croft who... It was not like to Lara Croft from the video games where she's learning how to do all this stuff in front of us.
And the one thing that I appreciated from this movie that was different from... the previous two installments was this was not a sex symbol.
Yeah, this was not.
You know, she was
sexy Lara Croft slowly getting out of the water.
Yeah, this was I'm gonna kick your ass.
Alicia Vikander did amazing as Lara. I can't wait to get the sequel from where they're supposed to be moving on to a sequel.
Sucks that the pandemic really kind of stalled a lot of these movies because you think like, oh, it's 2018. But you figure most action sequels come out in like 2 to 3 years, and action films obviously take a bigger budget, so it was safe to stay away from this. But
that's one of the things. Like, this was probably a decent sized budget. It felt dirty, gritty.
Gritty, yeah.
You're watching her like ping pong all through the water when she's tumbling toward the waterfall.
And she got her ass kicked.
Yeah, she takes damage. Like again, early Laura, like she's taking damage left and right. She's fighting back, but she's getting it just as good as she's giving out.
And this was, once again, your pick for us to go review. And I watched the ones with Angelina Jolie. I wasn't really impressed with them because it was like, to my understanding, this character was supposed to be a badass, but she's a sex symbol where everybody's drooling all over her.
Yeah.
Nobody's drooling for this one. She's just going to come and kick your ass. Yeah, and that's why it definitely, and like I said, I can't wait to look for the sequel as well.
Yeah.
Go with your number 6.
My number 6 is Ready Player One. Oh, I loved it. I loved everything about Ready Player One. The virtual reality world, where you just like, even just like, go sitting down and watching, just pulling out all of the background characters, Batman and Freddy and Jason and the Gundam. It's just so much fun. The Shining level, the video game, like that's... I'd much rather be in that world than this one.
Most of the time you are in that world.
Always. Just put me in that role. I want to be in the Oasis.
My number 6 is Rambo Last Blood from 2019, starring Sylvester Stallone. Now, the Rambo series for me has been up and down. I'm glad like this one is kind of like, at least... for now, the last one.
Well, see, the Rambo series has always been more like up for me, like barring that weird ending on Rambo 3 that did not age well.
There you go.
But
the
I haven't seen Last Blood though.
Last Blood is like a gore fest of action. Now, obviously, Sylvester Stallone's like 80 years old in this one, but you know, he's still bulky, but he knows he can't.
Like, you grabbed 80, but I'm willing to bet he's probably in his
60s, maybe 70s. But in this one, you know, he is an older Rambo, and he can still fight hand-to-hand, but he knows he can't last in the fight long. So a lot of times he does guerrilla-type warfare.
Well, he's always been guerrilla warfare.
Yeah, that's true, too.
He's 75.
75, so see, I was closer than you thought I was. But in this one, you know, there was more explosions, more underground stuff, him busting jaws and cracking heads. Very graphic. Like, yeah, more graphic than the last couple of Rambo films have been.
Well, he was using the underground tunnels between America and Mexico, fighting the cartels and everything, right?
That and he had underground tunnels built on his farm for when they attacked him. So his whole farm was a booby trap. It was insane. Story kind of is not much there. Basically, his maid or good friend's daughter gets kidnapped, you know, in the sex trafficking world, and he goes down to Mexico to get her back, which he does, but then, of course, there's the aftermath of now they gotta come get him, because all the stuff that he found out. So the plot was pretty much basic for what you want, but action was there, big time. And that's why that made my list.
I was sitting here trying to figure out what your number five was. I just figured it out. Your handwriting is terrible.
I'm surprised yours is as neat as it is today. Okay, minus the cue cards, okay? We got cue cards, we got a menu for us to read off of, and his cue cards you can't read, okay?
I can read them.
You can, not me.
My number five, barring your stupidity, is I tried to avoid comic book movies as much as I could, but, like, give me a break.
You can't.
It's an entire decade.
Yeah, they dominated, you can't.
And my number five was Marvel, Avenger Endgame. It was the perfect conclusion to a decade story running.
Yeah, because that was 2019.
It all came together.
Yeah, it was a perfectly. Thing of beauty.
That final hour in Endgame is must watch.
Yeah.
God, it does not stop. It doesn't let you go. As soon as that fight starts.
An amazing thing, like, one of the best scenes was when Captain America goes, Avengers,
assemble.
Like,
yeah.
We waited since
theater
what?
Exploded.
Yeah, we waited since 2012 for him to say that. And they made sure every Avengers movie, he avoided that line.
Yeah.
And then they gave us what we wanted. And it was
intense. Like ripped straight from the book of, like, all the bad guys and every one of the heroes just colliding in a battle.
Yeah.
Just ripped straight from a comic and just wonderful.
And like you said, it's the build up to get to this film made it so much better because, like, when this MCU started, we were literally like 17 years old. We grew into men with the first phase of the MCU.
Well, men is stretching it.
Yeah.
That's right. Men is stretching it.
Well, I mean, I did get married, got two
that
houses.
That doesn't mean anything. Not a damn thing.
But. Even though, like,
the housing bubble is real.
Even when they brought all that, I got emotional because I'm like, my God, I started as a 17-year-old, and here we are, and this is
43 years old.
No. But it gave the emotions. It brought in, like I said, every character, the battle.
You had the fun little team-ups. So, like, you had all the women just beating the hell out of everyone. You had Captain Marvel going toe-to-toe with Thanos, which was Thanos tried to headbutt her, and he just, like, fell to a knee, like, oh, no.
And then,
Scarlet Witch owning him and him just firing down on his people to get her off.
And even Captain America having his own on him, too. Finally him raising
Mjolnir.
And then, of course, Fat Thor was like, I knew it.
I knew it. No, you give me that. You take the little one.
Yeah. Or when the heroes return, of course, the new Captain America, a.k.a. the Falcon.
On your left.
Yeah, on your left, like, callbacks right there to the Winter Soldier. It was insane.
You had Black Panther being the first one out, followed by all his
armies.
It
was emotional. Good action. Yeah, CGI, of course, whatever. Say what you want to say, but it was a great film.
Yeah.
A good conclusion to that phase. My number five is Skyfall.
Oh, to this day... We're going to have some fun when we get deeper into the...
To this date, I do think that is the best Daniel Craig James Bond film. I know the series has wrapped up. I think his character's peak was in this film. It had the cross... This film was mostly, basically, not only, of course, he's fighting the baddie that was pulling the strings for the first two films. You start seeing more of the action-packed gun weapons James Bond, because he went from the younger James Bond that we saw that was taking the beatings and getting back up to busting knee, you know, his knees giving up on him. He's not a young pup anymore. And then you've seen that crossover towards the more fancier weapons.
That's what I want to see. James Bond with arthritis. Exciting times.
You had your typical Bond girls and everything else like that. I still
was
remember...
this the one with the shadow fight in the tower?
No, I think that was the next one.
Where they fought in the shadows kind of deal. You could only see like the outline.
Yeah, that was the next one.
Yeah.
But still, this had it all for me. You know, James Bond was going up against another former agent that was basically more psychological with henchmen. Something he wasn't quite used to. And like I said, you saw the transition. In this series, you saw this was the transition film. The rest of the last couple of films were eh, but this was the peak for me.
Just wait till we get to the 90s.
Okay, your number four.
It's Deadpool. Four is Deadpool. You gotta count him. Like, he was the perfect kind of breath of fresh air into the comic book world. Because we'd always gotten like that PG-13 where they were like, oh, it's adult, they murdered off screen with no blood, and then you get Deadpool. You're just like, and I'm going to stab you, cuss out this guy.
They always said rated R, it wouldn't work as a rated R comic book film, but it became one of the highest rated R films of all times, like in the top three.
Yeah, it surpassed Blade.
Yeah.
I would curse you out while chasing you on a Zamboni.
What made this more passion for the fans was how much Ryan Reynolds wanted to make Deadpool
He wanted this more than anything. His love showed for a long time before he finally got the opportunity to do it.
Yeah, like his passion brought the fans up, because he's like, I didn't like what they did to Deadpool in Wolverine Origins. We gotta make this guy talk. We gotta make him do the fourth wall, breaking the fourth wall. And they did it all.
Yep, they knocked
it out. Here comes the superhero landing. Here comes the superhero
landing. Superhero landing.
That's so bad on the knees. It had the jokes.
All the call-outs. Everything you'd expect to see from a Deadpool movie.
And like even his shot at like Fox and with the X-Men franchise, like, we can't get the real X-Men in here.
Oh, Deadpool 2, when he finally gets into the thing and you see all the X-Men in the one.
Yeah, but he doesn't
see
them.
They close the door where you can notice.
Yeah. It did all those callbacks. It really...
This big old mansion, you two are the only two here.
Yeah. Right?
He made... Was it Megasonic Teenage Warhead? A character?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. How many, like, before Deadpool would have been able
never
to...
Never heard of that
her?
Character.
Like, now, she was in the two movies.
Yeah, and she became more of a popular character ever before.
Yeah.
But let's... My number four.
This is going to catch you some heat.
It's not the best overall Spider-Man film. I am talking about The Amazing Spider-Man 2.
No, don't dig yourself out. Just say why you like it.
I like it because, you know, they gave us the Gwen Stacy,
death.
You saw the pain. I think any Spider-Man movie is going to have your typical web action.
So I think Andrew Garfield is way underrated.
Oh, yeah.
And his performance as Spider-Man is really good.
I will say this. I seen, you know, we actually both went to Spider-Man.
No Way Home.
No Way Home. I gotta be honest, like, Tobey Maguire got a big reaction.
Yeah.
But it kind of did seem like Andrew got a
bigger one. Yeah.
Like, the audience...
It did see that in my theater.
Yeah.
It did seem people popped more for Garfield than they did
Maguire. Yeah, like, when Garfield appeared, everybody went like, oh my god, he's back! When Maguire showed up, it was like, yay! Okay, he's back, cool! But, yeah.
Amazing Spider-Man 2, like, I think the only problem with Amazing Spider-Man 2 is the goblin.
Yeah, I...
They didn't have to make him look like
that. An actual goblin. I know Electro making him blue was not a fan thing.
I liked that shade. Like, when he absorbed so much power, he changed.
I liked the grid fight.
Yeah.
That was unique. Like I said, the goblin character was just a little bit too much. The Rhino was, you know...
Not utilized.
Yeah. Like I said, a lot of people will take... I felt what hurt this film the most was probably too many villains. Like, they literally saw the issues that were wrong with Spider-Man 3 and put them in Amazing Spider-Man 2.
Yeah.
That's basically what hurt Amazing Spider-Man 2. Everybody praises Garfield. Gwen.
Emma Stone was
Emma Stone as Gwen was fantastic. Jamie Foxx as Electro. No complaints
there. I thought he was good, too. Like, I mean, his Electro was better in No Way Home.
Right.
But I do see where they were going with him here. Like, he wanted to be noticed.
Yeah.
And then people finally noticed him when he was Electrode, and the moment Spider-Man showed up, no one cared anymore about him.
Exactly. So, you know, I know with No Way Home, they want Spider-Man 4. They want Amazing Spider-Man 3. I don't know if we'll ever get those, but this holds...
No, I'll take Amazing Spider-Man 3 over Spider-Man 4.
I think there is unfinished
business. What are we talking about when we say Spider-Man 4?
Tell me why.
No. Amazing Spider-Man 3 over that
there
one.
There you go.
I was about to say, are we talking about Holland coming back or Spider-Man?
No.
I want that.
The Sony one. But nevertheless...
Put down.
Never... number four, that was mine.
Don't show off your stupid socks.
It's NASA. You're matching today.
Yeah, no.
Like my work socks.
My number three is Predators. Much like Spider-Man 2, just not to that degree, obviously. A lot of people hate on Predators for no reason. It's wonderful. I love the fact that we're on their planet. It would make sense, like, oh, well, maybe it's too hot on Earth or something like that. Let's bring the prey here.
Yeah.
Much like we do with other animals, where we just trap them into an enclosure and hunt them from there. That's what predators do on this one, and then you're on that planet, so you're able to have these warring tribes around that they don't quite get along with one another. Andrew Brody, I thought, was a really good main character here, being more representative of what body types look like then and now, compared to what they look like in the 80s, where you're more lean. More fit that way, as opposed to just being muscles on top of muscles. It felt like that was a good new age way to go. I love seeing all the Predator variations, the fights. Well, I'd say fights. We didn't get a whole lot of fights. It was just like Predator killing and explosions. And you did like that samurai with the sword who challenged the Predator. I love that scene.
Right.
Because it's like the Predator knew that this was an honor fight. He was being challenged. You have to meet that challenge.
My number three is an action comedy sequel, 22 Jump Street. This movie brought the laughs, brought enough action to be an action film. My name is Jim.
I saw the trailer, I'm like, absolutely fucking not.
But see, that's the thing. It was actually a good, funny action movie. It brought back Channing Tatum and
Jonah Hill. Yeah, he's done nothing since. Except for Magic Mike, I think.
I think that's true. Jonah Hill's curl hair has been, like, skyrocketing at times.
Look, Channing's still trying to be Gambit.
Yeah, he's pleasing the Marvel fan. He's like, hey, I want this role. This was a good follow-up to the first film. I like that they brought the characters into college because they couldn't do high school again, even though Jump Street was all about high school days. It was about still following another drug deal thing. It's kind of what they did.
That's Jump Street, though.
Yeah. But the ironically thing enough, they, like Deadpool, they broke the fourth wall a little bit. Like, they can't do the same thing twice, can they? Like, didn't we already do this? Ice Cube in this one really, like, busted out of this film. And the mean chief captain that they had, Jonah Hill character banging his daughter and them dabbing up was a hilarious scene. But you still had the action. You had, I mean, Jonah Hill was, you know, he's not going to be the action star. You did have Channing carrying the...
No, you had Jonah to make the jokes and Channing to carry the action.
basically. And the combination really worked for me.
Everybody comedy of all time.
All time. What?
That's everybody comedy. You have one carrying the action, one making the jokes.
And as long as the story...
it's a formula. It's a formula that works. That's how we got Rush Hour.
And that was a hilarious franchise right there.
No, I just grabbed one out of the air. We can do a top ten of buddy comedy.
Men in Black too, yeah. Men in Black, but that is my number three.
Well, Men in Black's a little different. That is one guy making jokes and the other one looking surly.
That is true. Go with your number two.
My number two is Sherlock Holmes' Game of Shadows. Oh, I loved the team up of Robert Downey and Jude Law. Those guys have such great chemistry, and in the sequel, they have got their characters down, and they can make them grow, and that's what they did. I loved the Moriarty in this. He felt like a real threat to Sherlock, who's almost feels like he's on the ropes at times, and at the very end, you realize, no, he knew all the time. He'd have got him pegged from the very start. You know, to tumble off the waterfall, leading to you believing he's dead, and of course... He's sitting in the room at the end, and he's dressed like the chair.
They didn't make a third one yet,
did they? It's in the works.
Okay.
I think Robert Downey's schedule was a little bit too hard, and they needed time to meet up.
Yeah. A little bit better. All right.
But yeah, Game of Shadows is fantastic. I love the action scene. The fights on the train, going through the war-torn areas. Oh, it was amazing.
My number two, Captain America, the Winter Soldier. At the time, and maybe still, it is definitely one of the best comic book sequels we have had. This changed...
You have a comic book movie ahead of it, so...
Yeah, but I said one of them.
Yeah.
See?
Okay.
The political aspect to it was something different.
Well, it was very Jason Bourne-y, right? With the conspiracy.
Yeah,
it was
conspiracy and cover-ups.
Yeah.
Then you add it... definitely in today's CGI heavy with the Marvel films, this was kind of more grounded.
Ground and bound.
Yeah. Like the fights out between the Winter Soldier and Captain America, there was no CGI.
Even at the beginning with the Leaper on the boat, that was a great fight to kick things off.
Yeah, it was all ground and pound.
I saw one person be like, why is this one henchman able to keep up with the captain? It's like, that's not a henchman.
Yeah, he.
That's Brock the Leaper.
Yeah, he.
I think it's his name.
Yeah.
Brock the Leaper.
He's
the Leaper. Like, he's a very good fighter. He's not a joke.
Understand, Captain America is not, you know, he's super strong, but he's not, like, he's not monster level strong.
Yeah.
You know, guys that know how to fight can keep their pace with him, which we saw.
The thing that Cap separates everyone from Cap is Cap's stamina.
Yeah, his resilience. He's able to last much, much longer. And that could be the heart that he has. But
the heart, the resilience.
Yeah. The Winter Soldier was just like, you know what? I'm going to match tit for tat with you. And he kept his own. They kept him in the shadows, like, you know, just killing who he needs to kill. He was a... The only thing I don't like is I know, like, the Winter Soldier, they try to separate the Winter Soldier from Bucky. Like, Bucky can't remember everything the Winter Soldier does.
Yeah.
But it just sucks because... That would just make Bucky such more of a badass.
Well, I mean, it does leak through his subconscious and everything, and he is remembering, but that comes later.
Yeah.
I will say this, huge leap up from the first Captain America
movie. Oh.
Massive improvement. Like, you could, that's night and day.
Level. Yeah. Most trilogies and film series, the first one's it. Like,
yeah,
and then it takes a dive.
It could take a dive, or keep pace, but very rarely will it, like, supersede the first one.
Yeah, you went from like a level 1 to a level 7 with Captain with the sequel difference. Like, the gap was so big that...
I mean, on even our grade scale, like, Cap 1 is like D.
Yeah.
And Winter Soldier is A to S tier movie.
Yeah, like, it's insane. And this was, what, the Russo brothers' first film in the MCU?
Was it the Russo brothers'
first film? Yeah,
I'm willing to bet just secured them for Infinity War and Endgame to come down.
Yeah. But that is that's one of my favorites, The Winter Soldier.
That brings me up to my number one. Paul's rolling his eyes already because he's like, of course it'd be an animated movie.
Yes, it is.
It's Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. I was never a really big Miles Morales fan. I always had Spider-Man and Gwen Stacy's Ghost Spider ahead of him. This one made me more of a Miles fan, though. They did so good. The animation style is so brilliantly done. It's gorgeous to look at. Feels like you're just, there's just, someone's just thumbing a comic book in front of the camera.
Yeah.
I love everything. I love
I enjoyed the older Spider-Man.
Yeah.
That was just kind of like,
Yeah, oh, yeah, he's like, I'm kind of done with this shit. I don't
know. That was my favorite, honestly.
Grumpy Spider-Man throughout. That's good Spider-Man. He doesn't quite fit his uniform anymore. He's kind of given up.
Where is it? Where's that trench coat?
I love the, well, another thing about it I loved about, like, especially with Ghost Spider comic books, and you got it here, is the different variations on the villains. Like, you saw the female scientist, and you kind of trust her and everything, and then you realize, oh no, that's Ock. that's Dr. Ock.
And there's a sequel coming.
Yeah, oh, this year is my number one.
There you go.
But this was good stuff, start to finish. Paul's just a heathen. We'll be talking more about his hatred for animation in about a week.
I don't have a hatred. It's just, I don't put them in the same category as live action. Oh,
he's got problems, people.
My number one is Avengers Infinity War. We knew there was rumors that this film was going to be in two parts and everything else like that. The build-up was starting. The war, the fight with Thanos was coming.
Yeah.
His lieutenants. I don't even want to call them henchmen because they were more lieutenants.
There were generals.
Yeah, his generals were coming to Earth. They did their job of, well, not on purpose, I don't think, but they got the teams to separate.
They got rid of the villain. They waited until the villains who could beat him were gone.
Yeah.
Hela, Ego, Odin.
Yeah.
They had fallen, so that the only line of defense left were the Avengers, who had splintered.
Yeah, from the Civil War outbreak. Then you had, of course, it packed the action. But then, you had the laughs.
Yeah, the emotional fall.
Yeah, the ending when you finally realize the good guys lost.
Yeah.
And they're confused at what's actually happened because he snapped his finger and what he set out to do, he did. He snapped his finger with the Infinity Stones and
50% was gone.
50% was gone. And we didn't know who was coming and who was going. And, the one that shocked me the most was Spider-Man.
Yeah.
But he also had the best heartfelt, fading away. What's going on? And then
I don't feel so good or something.
Yeah, and then he realized it was going, I don't want to die. They gave him the spotlight because he was probably the biggest character.
Then you had deaths like Gamora and Loki, and it's like, if you reverse the snap, you're still not bringing them back.
Yeah, and kudos to Marvel for finding ways to do that with the alternate timelines now and all that, but nevertheless, this was just unique because the bad guys won. Thanos proved he was who he was, and he was a beast, and we saw the Avengers from every film, they always succeed in the end. They didn't in this film, and that was something so different. How many films... Now, we knew something was going to happen at the end because we knew Endgame was going to come.
Yeah.
But we, maybe thought... I thought maybe, they could have stopped it, and then he gets his crew involved, whatever. But no, he won. And then they go on this... it leads into the next film to them all going their separate ways and being depressed, but started it. So that was my
number one. You had the tease for Captain Marvel at the end when Samuel Jackson was just dusting and he hits the button and you see her logo pop up on the beeper.
Yeah, good little cameo.
That was a good Easter egg. This is what's coming next.
Yep. So that is our action decade.
Next, when we get to the next decade, there's going to be some fights on that one. Paul's going to be very wrong in many, many ways.
But until next time.
Bye-bye.